Welcome back, geology fans. With all the tilted, folded, and altered rock out there, it would be helpful to have a guide to the original order and position of rock units in an area. As the main principle at play here is the law of superposition, it is easiest to represent the rock units in order as a vertical column with the oldest rocks at the bottom and the youngest at the top, which is known as a stratigraphic column. Each rock unit in the column is overlain with symbols for rock type and any distinctive features, sometimes colored in to correspond with map colors, with extra information given in the width of the units and notes on the side. The width of the rock in your stratigraphic column can be used in a number of ways that we will discuss more in a moment, but it is going to be used on our sheets as giving grain size of the rocks, with smaller grains being shown by thinner width. During your preliminary investigations, before going out into the field, you might find a comprehensive stratigraphic column for your area may already be available. It is so much easier to see deformations in the rock if you know how they were originally organized before being deformed. If you have an expected pattern in your head and see something that doesn't follow that pattern, you are much more likely to note it. But even if you have a general stratigraphic column for your area, it may be useful to make a stratigraphic column within your field area to get an idea of how these units vary. Some beds can deposit with thicknesses varying in hundreds of meters, and this can be quite informative about the environments of deposition or crustal movements. So it is essential that we geologists know how to construct one of these stratigraphic columns ourselves. During preliminary investigations, we try to identify a well-exposed and relatively undeformed sequence where we can easily traverse across the grain, that is, perpendicular to the bedding of the rock. This will help us when we get into the areas of poor exposure or more severe deformation. Now, if you're thinking you can measure bed thickness just by using the pace method we covered in episode 10, from one side of the formation to the other side, or just using a tape measure across the surface, that would only work if the rock beds are tilted exactly 90 degrees vertically and the ground perfectly flat. First of all, the Earth's surface is often not perfectly flat, and the beds of rock are rarely positioned exactly 90 degrees on edge. The other, and more common, extreme position of horizontal beds would show only one rock type on a flat surface, but a surface with varied topography incised into horizontal rock beds would have contacts between beds parallel to contour lines. As we tilt the beds of rock, they will intersect the beds in thinner and thinner stripes, and if we fold or fault the rock, the stripes get more interesting. We can get a quick idea of which way beds are tilting when they cross valleys, horizontal beds being parallel to contour lines, V upstream the same as and parallel to contour lines. As layers tilt dipping upstream into the valley, the V still points upstream and starts crossing the contour lines as it reaches less and less up the valley. The bed exposures eventually become a straight line across the valley if it is tilted 90 degrees on edge, starting from horizontal again. If beds dip downstream, the V pattern upstream initially creeps up and then gets more severe until it breaks into two lines, two parallel lines on either side of the valley, if the bed dips at the same slope as the valley grade. With the rock beds dipping steeper than the grade of the stream downstream, the bed exposure at the surface eventually joins to make a V downstream. So downstream dipping beds are dipping in the downstream direction. As we increase the downstream dip, the downstream V gets less and less severe until it is a straight line across when the bed is vertical. Sure helps to have a cutaway view. But how do we measure a bed's thickness if we can't see it from the side? We need a way to measure bed thicknesses of often tilted rocks on a terrain that is rarely flat. The age-old tool for this is the Jakobs Staff, which is basically a rod at or slightly above your eye height, often about 2 meters long, which has gradations along its edge, and often a holder for your compass or clinometer. That is your tilt meter, though some of the fancy new models have the clinometer already attached. These are always made out of non-ferrous materials, like wood or aluminum. Iron will mess with your compass. The Jakobs staff is a measuring stick that you will place exactly perpendicular to the bedding so that you are always measuring true thickness. The first step, then, is to get the general strike and dip of the beds you are measuring. And here you might think about the bed's dip and dip direction. You're going to lean the Jakobs staff in the same direction as that bed's dip and dip direction and at the same angle, as if your staff were a line coming perpendicular right out of the bed from below it. Traditionally, the sight on the Jakobs staff is set 1.5 meters up the shaft. Looking along this sight perpendicular to the shaft, the point on Earth where your sight is leading you is exactly 1.5 meters of rock thickness from the base of the staff where you stand. You can now take the time to describe in detail the rock in that 1.5 meter thickness and place it on your strat column. Then advance to the point you sighted, placing the base of the staff exactly on the sighted point, or a point parallel to bedding from that point, and repeat. Avoid going parallel to bedding from a sighted point if possible, as that will cause error, and be careful of getting your tilt angle exact on the Jakobs staff. A 3-degree error in tilt can result in large errors in bed thickness. This can be made worse by measuring down what are known as dip slopes, surfaces exactly parallel and almost certainly due to bedding. You have to sight a point very far away from you. The opposite case, where the slope is opposite the direction of dip of the beds, is the easiest to contend with. Here is our imaginary geologist, starting by placing the base of their staff at the base of their section, tilting the same direction and dip as the beds being measured, and sighting, which you can see is a projection parallel to the bedding. And the point sighted is up rock section, the same amount as the height of the sight on the Jakobs staff, 1.5 meters usually. Here are some various combinations of rock dip and surface slope and how you would have to place your Jakobs staff to get the proper thickness measurement. If you would like to make your own Jakobs staff, a piece of wood measuring 2.5 by 5 by 200 centimeters, 1 by 2 by 75 inches, is often recommended. Make your measurement gradations across the wide edge, perpendicular across the rod. Centimeters or decimeter divisions are most common. Rubber bands can suffice to fix your compass, which has a clinometer, to the staff. Using the sight of your compass at 1.5 meters as your sight, and so making sure it is exactly positioned on the staff, with your Jakobs staff ready and knowledge of its use, you begin to measure sections 1.5 meters at a time and recording observations on your stratigraphy columns. Our notes page on iTunes has a PDF file of a blank stratigraphy chart you can use to make your observations. There are standard symbols for common sedimentary, igneous, and metamorphic rocks, and symbols for common features you may encounter. And you can always make up symbols for the less usual features you may encounter and keep a key to the side of your strat column. You will notice that the blank strat column I have posted on iTunes note page has grain size divisions to allow you to indicate the predominant grain size in the rock by thickness of the column. That is because most strat columns are dealing with sedimentary rock, and grain size is pretty important there. So fine grain shales, mudstones, and siltstones get the skinniest sections in the column, and conglomerates are the widest. But since this is an arbitrary indicator, the width of a strat column can be used to indicate any variable you want, really, but indicate what it is your width is a measure of on the strat column page. As wells are dug, geologists on site create well logs. As the drill tip penetrates the rocks below, the geologist identifies the rock and puts the appropriate rock symbol at that relative depth in a uniform width lithologic column. You can then lower sensing devices down the borehole and measure things like electrical conductivity, porosity, nuclear magnetic resonance, or whatever you can think of. And those parameters get plotted like a linear strat column with the position of the line indicating the level of the recorded parameter. But the most likely alternate column width indication you will see is a competence column, where rocks that are soft and erode easily, perhaps making saddles or valleys on the landscape, are indicated on your column as skinnier beds that are eroding back, whereas more resistant rocks that stand out and up are indicated as wider layers on the column that stick out. This is a more intuitive looking column than our lithologic column, and there may be reasons to make either one in specific locations, but be sure to indicate which column you are making. Lastly, you could make a chronostratigraphic column, which places the rocks you see on an absolute time scale, thus making the recorded rock record versus the unconformities rather apparent. These columns are various ways of organizing the rocks in your field area to help you recognize patterns and anomalies more easily. They help you know where you are in a rock record as you walk across a terrain and help you imagine what rocks must be below your feet. And if you walk in a line across a terrain imagining what is below your feet, you are imagining a subsurface cross-section, which is the topic of our next episode, here on Earth Explorations.